So we will start a new chapter today. It's a gradually varied flow, and we are approached towards the end of our syllabus. Okay, so we have only two units left out. One is your gradually varied flow and rapidly varied flow. It's not that long. Okay, then we'll have another one unit. Okay, so here I think gradually varied flow we have already discussed. Okay, in first chapter. If you remember a gradually varied flow, if you have the bottom of the channel and the flow is flowing in this direction, okay, from upper elevation to the lower elevation, the water is flowing, and then if you construct any obstruction to the flow of water, any obstruction to the flow of water. So after this, when you construct the obstruction, your flow of water is increasing, okay, increasing, and then it's overflow. This phenomenon in the upstream section is called gradually varied. Okay, gradually varied flow. So these things I have already discussed to you. Okay, so that in the upstream your depth of flow is gradually increasing. Okay, so that is the difference between your gradually varied flow and rapidly varied flow. If your depth of flow change drastically, suppose you consider the same case when you substitute the obstruction, your flow of water gradually varying or gradually increasing, and then when it falls at the downstream end, okay, it strikes at the bottom of the channel and your depth of flow increases. Okay, so if you see here, your depth of flow, this is your bottom of the channel. If you see here, your depth of flow changes drastically with a very short period of length. Okay, you see the distance is not that much, but your depth of flow, it changes drastically. Here it's very less. If you see here, it's comparatively, this is a very high value. Okay, so this phenomenon is called rapidly varied flow. Okay, rapidly varied flow. And in the upstream, you can see that your this depth of flow is gradually increasing. Gradually, it's not rapidly increasing, it's gradually increasing. Okay, it's gradually increasing. So this phenomenon is called gradually varied flow. Okay, gradually varied. So we have a dynamic equation for gradually varied flow. So we are going to derive this dynamic equation. Okay, so before derivation, we have some assumption for a dynamic equation of gradually varied flow. Okay, so for this assumption, you kindly write down this assumption. Okay, next topic you write dynamic equation of GVF, that is your gradually varied flow. Dynamic equation of GVF. Okay, so here you can see this structure, this wire, and you see the water is flowing. Okay, before it is y naught, and because of this obstruction, it's gradually increasing your flow, and at the final stage, it's overflow over the wire. Okay, so in the upstream only you can observe gradually varied flow. If you consider the downstream section of the wire, you're going to get rapidly varied flow. Okay, So next topic is dynamic equation of GVF and you write assumption. So you write the first assumption, slope of the canal bed assumed to be very small. Okay, slope of the canal bed assumed to be very small so that depth of Y is same in all section. Slope of the canal bed assumed to be very small so that depth of Y is same in all direction. Depth of Y is same in all direction. Done. First assumption. Then you write the second assumption. Channel is prismatic. Okay. I think everyone know what is prismatic channel. Prismatic channel is nothing but we consider the whole cross section of that particular channel is same. Suppose if you consider a river, if you see from the top width, from the top view, the width of the river generally changes. It's not constant. Okay, somewhere it less, somewhere it more, it's changing because the boundary of the river, it's not like a straight line, it's somewhat like this. Okay, see. You see from a top view, or you can use Google Map also to see, or if you want to track a river, you see that width of the channel is not constant, or it's not a straight line. Okay, and if you see the cross section also for a river is somewhat like this, it's irregular shape. You cannot say which one is what. Okay, from the same for the same river. Okay, so if we consider in such an irregular shape and the variation of width of the channel, then it's very difficult to derive the dynamic equation. Okay, so these are the assumption to make your calculation simplification or simplified. Okay, so that is why we consider this channel is prismatic. That means we have a constant width of the river and with a constant shape. Suppose it is rectangular, that means the whole channel will be rectangular. If it is a trapezoidal, the whole section will be trapezoidal. If the width of the channel is 100 meter, that means it will be constant 100 meter through the channel. Though it is not, but we are assumed to be constant. Okay, so this is called prismatic channel. Okay, so the next assumption you write, number two, that channel is prismatic. Channel is prismatic and slope is same. Okay? And slope is same. Then you move on to the third assumption. Velocity coefficient. I think you are familiar with this term alpha. That is our velocity coefficient. Is assumed to be unity, or you can say alpha is equal to 1. So number four, again K and Z, okay, K and Z are exponential function of depth Y. What is K and Z? We are going to discuss during the derivation. Okay, so K and Z are exponential function of depth Y. Then you move on to the fifth assumption, roughness coefficient n or c. That is, n is for Mannings, c is for Sage's constant, okay, and f is the friction. Roughness coefficient n or c or small f is independent of depth of flow, okay, and constant throughout the channel. Okay, roughness coefficient n or c. See, when we talk about our Mannings n or roughness coefficient, so that roughness coefficient, it depends on the bed materials of the river. Okay, so if you consider a river and the upstream section, you can say that bed material is more about your rocks, okay, during hilly areas, because of the hilly areas, okay. But when you move towards the downstream or towards the lower elevation of the channel, then you can find that your river bed is your sandy particles or something like that, okay. So your river bed is not constant, it changes, okay. So if the river bed changes, bed material changes, then your roughness is also changes, okay. But in this derivation, we assume the your roughness coefficient will be same throughout the channel ridge or throughout the river, okay. Similarly for Sage's constant or friction factor F, we consider it as constant, okay. That is why it's written independent of depth of flow and constant throughout the channel, okay. Then we move on to our number six, assumption number six, or you can say it's our last assumption. Okay, last assumption you write. The head loss at a certain section is same as for uniform flow. Okay, the head loss at a certain section is same as for an uniform flow. So that is why uniform flow formula such as Mannings and Sage's equations are applicable in gradually varied flow to find the energy flow. Okay, so this is the last assumption. The head loss at a certain section is same as for an uniform flow, but this for gradually varied flow is not our uniform flow, because the depth of flow is changing with distance. Okay, as we move towards the barrage or the obstruction, our depth of flow increases. Okay, so we cannot say it's a uniform flow, but this is just an assumption. Okay, to find out the friction slope, we are going to use Mannings and Sage's equation, and Mannings and Sage's equation applicable for uniform flow. Okay, so we consider it like an uniform flow, and we use these equations to find out SF. Okay, this is the assumption, last assumption. So you write like this: the head loss at a certain section is same as for an uniform flow. That is, uniform flow formula such as Mannings and Sage's equation are applicable in gradually varied flow to find the energy slope SF. Over. Okay, so we move on to the derivation now. Okay, so assumption is done. Okay, so if it is visible, you draw the diagram. Okay, is it visible? So this is the bed of the bed of the channel. This is your bed of the channel. Okay, I think similar diagram we have already drawn. Okay, in previous image, this is the bed of the channel. Then we have considered two section, one and two. First section, this is total energy line. Total energy line. Okay, or you can like total energy. Okay, so will be v square by twice g. Then we have y value and then we have z. Okay, and this whole energy head is called h. Okay, similarly for section 2. Okay, so here it's written total energy line. This is the total energy line. Okay, so there will be some loss. This is your v2 square by twice z, v2 square divided by twice z, or you can write alpha v2 square by twice z. Okay, here v2 and this will be z2. Okay, so there will be some loss because of this friction. Okay, so that loss is dh. The loss is nothing but your dh. Okay, so this is your total h. Whatever the energy you are getting here, that energy level here, it will be little bit reduced because of the friction loss. Okay, so that loss is your dh. Okay, and this is your datum level. Okay, datum level will be a straight line. Okay, so here it seems like a inclined one, so the don't confuse, it's a like a straight line because it's a hand drawing. We hand drawn is done, so that's why it seems like inclined one, but you draw as a straight line. Your datum is a reference line and it's a straight with respect to which we are going to find out the total energy of a particular section. Okay, and difference between these two section is dx. Okay, so difference between that this distance, difference between the two section is dx. So I request you to compare with the section A students, okay, what I have discussed with them. If any topic we left out in previous section, that is your specific energy, you just let me know. Okay, if I, because it's a huge gap now because of this assessment, I didn't remember where I have stopped in previous chapter, that is your specific energy. Okay, so you just discuss with the section A students because they have already completed long back this specific energy, and they have started this GVF also, it's about to end. Okay, so you just compare with them, and if any topic left out, you just let me know. Okay, so that we can discuss again. So it's done, the diagram. So we move on. then you write total head H. Total head H, okay, capital H. H has energy above datum at the upstream of the is given by at the upstream is given by you write this expression, okay. So head is nothing but your total energy. So for total energy, if you remember, we will be having three components. One is your datum head, that is your Z, plus your pressure head, that is your Y, or depth of flow, and the last one is your kinetic velocity head or kinetic head, V square by twice C. Okay, as the V is not constant throughout this section, we are going to multiply by a component that is called alpha. Okay, and if you remember in the assumption, we have considered this alpha is equal to 1. That's the second assumption. Okay, so you can directly write V square by twice G. Okay, so you can see, you can directly write this expression Z plus Y V square by twice G, because for alpha we have considered 1. Over. So then we have to differentiate, okay. Okay, I think you have understood H is nothing but your total energy head, because everything what you are going to find, that is V square by 2G, that unit is also in meter, Y is also in meter because it's a depth of flow. And Z value, that is your datum head, is also in meter. So whatever the total value you are going to get here also, it will be in meter. So it's a head. Okay. So you can also tell it's called total energy head. Okay. So now we have to differentiate this head, total head, with respect to X. Okay. So dH by dx. Okay. The differentiating with H with respect to X. So dH by dx is equal to Z is also dz by dx plus dy by dx plus dd of x V square by twice Z. And you put equation number 1. Substitute equation number 1. Okay. So we consider this equation as the 1. And you can write where dH by dx, that is change in depth, sorry, change in head with respect to distance. This is nothing but your slope of the total energy line. Okay, slope of the total energy line. If you take 10 theta, if you take 10 theta, because suppose this is your river, bed river, level of water. And if you see here, we'll be having V square by twice C, okay? So if you take two section, 1 and 2, so there will be some angle, right? If you draw this as a straight line, because here the level reduces because of the loss, okay? This is your section 1, This is your section 2. So because of this, if you draw a straight line, okay, if you draw a straight line like this, and this angle is theta, okay, so if you take 10 theta, this is nothing but your dh loss in head. This is your dh. This is your total energy line. This is your energy line. This line. Okay, this blue line is your energy line, because here it's more and here it's reduces. How much it reduces? That is your dh. If you take 10 theta, then this difference is again dx, we have already discussed. Okay, so dh by dx is nothing but your slope of total energy line. Okay, and is given by SF. Okay, so here again you write dh by dx, we are going to consider as a negative, since your head decreases when x increases. So when we increase the distance, you see that your frictional loss or whatever the loss is, it will be more. Okay, and because of this your head reduces. So when we increase the x value, your head reduces, so we are going to consider as a negative. Okay, so next term is your dz by dx. Okay, so dz by dx is nothing but the slope of the bed, and it's represented by sb, bed slope. Okay, and it is also negative since your z decreases as your x increases. Okay, if you see the diagram, you can clearly identify when we consider the second section, you can see your z value decreases. So if you further increase the distance, your datum head will decrease. Okay, so that is why we are going to consider as negative. So from 11, no, your Rituraj sir will take your class, okay? And my second class I will take from 1 p.m. Okay? So we'll continue with this derivation from 1 p.m., okay? Today. So from 11, your Rituraj sir will take your class. Okay? He has some work in the second half. Okay? So he is supposed to take your class after second half. So you have some urgent work, okay? So I'll be taking your class in the second half. And we continue with this derivation, your dynamic equation of gradually varied flow. Okay? So I'm ending this class here now, okay?